Hello and welcome to Shine HR Live. I'm your host Vasundhara and I'm here with a stellar panel to talk about employee engagement for retention post-COVID. Employee engagement and retention has emerged as the worst hit aspect of organization amid the COVID-19 pandemic. When it comes to employee engagement, the organizations are facing the challenges of lack of sense of association with the organization, reduced interconnectedness, communication, team collaboration, and work-life balance. This ongoing crisis has created a large supply-demand imbalance as companies fail to meet their talent needs. However, the dynamics of the employment market are changing. It's no secret that the pandemic has transformed the way organizations operate. Business as usual looks much different, if not completely unpredictable. In April 2021, the Bureau of Labor Statistics reported that 4 million people left their jobs, a trend many are referring to as Great Resignation. As employees are questioning the meaning of their work and rethinking what they want from their lives. To discuss this in detail, we have top HR leaders who will be discussing how to power employee engagement for retention post-COVID.
Very, critical theme, powering employee engagement for retention post-COVID. But let me just quickly give you a little glimpse of the larger business environment part of the context. Maybe in India, economy is opening up fairly well. But I think when we are looking at the global cues, maybe I think the kind of volatility and turbulence, especially when we are looking at the soaring energy prices, that is going to be a big challenge in maybe the next financial year. And maybe signs of degrowth are already being seen part of US and Europe. Maybe inflation globally is perhaps one of the highest in recent years. UK, for example, last 41 years, have never experienced 11% inflation. They are in a real bit of mess in terms of their economy. When we are looking at the global supply chain issues, especially auto industry in our case, Maruti's case, you know, the shortage of microchips have been playing havoc with us. So we are sitting more than 400,000, you know, kind of pending deliveries in one company. But overall industry may be a much bigger challenge. Also, maybe this rupee weakening against the dollar is not very healthy for us to look at next 3 years kind of business plan and maybe the kind of impact which we'll have on the global supply chain. Also, when we are looking at the competitive landscape, maybe we are looking for this change, maybe or this restructuring with startup companies and maybe very innovative business frameworks coming in, surprising competitors coming in from nowhere, and also this digital boom is going to create a new kind of challenge and perhaps new kind of jobs, new kinds of skill sets we have all been talking about. Three critical variables in my thinking are going to be part of this context. This emerging new normal, we have been talking last 2 years, what exactly will be the impact on people policies? We are looking at this employee well-being being a top priority, maybe the culture perspective, and then looking at engagement and retention challenge. And as Azusa said, maybe post-COVID, this is assuming larger proportions with US experiencing great resignations, while India people are looking at great realization. What is the quality of life in what kind of job, what kind of career they are going to look at? Maybe we are also looking at this big impact. Second variable is the digital boom. The potential is there, but disruption is also there. How we are going to really look at this challenge? And we are looking at this turbulence and volatility in the global environment. So there is no longer a kind of a isolated situation in India. Something happens globally somewhere and we get impacted. Perhaps when we are looking at HR, I think three very critical trends being talked about in the last 1 year. Change of nature of work, change of the workplace, and also change of the workforce. Perhaps we are looking at this very big fact of work from home, hybrid, work from office. What will be the kind of culture impact? What will be the kind of engagement challenge? Maybe we are also looking at new kind of people coming into the workforce, the gig economy, fixed-term employment. We are looking at maybe flexibility, which we have never earlier felt, maybe required by HR going forward to look at some of these new perspectives. In my thinking, maybe we may look to redefine the HR strategy in this very demanding business environment. This focus on employee well-being engagement and retention, maybe we'll have to restructure our aspirations on what is going to be the retention thinking in company. People are not going to work for you for 40 years anymore. I think we'll have to be more realistic. Maybe some mini models of engagement and retention we'll have to look at. Three things maybe I am just mentioning for maybe our panelists to look at. First, we'll have to look at selectively deleting the past so that we can look at this transformation. We are looking at culture perspective as one very big component how we are going to handle people in future around us. We are looking at the leadership as a very critical kind of component how we are going to, you know, engage with people. Maybe listening leadership, maybe compassionate leadership, some such perspective.
I would start with the first aspect that I have been discussing with my teams, which essentially is how do you, you know, make the 2 to 3 year journey of an employee memorable and give them the opportunity to choose to stick with you for a longer period of time. So it's a shift in the premise from long-term career retire from us mindset to, you know, what is your experience here and now? And it has to be good enough for you to want to stay with us. So that's the first part from an engagement perspective. And as we're crafting experiences, you know, kind of that's like literally the filter. The second aspect that, you know, I have started telling everybody is, you know, on a year-on-year basis, over the past few years, we've doubled our headcount. And we have brought in people from everywhere and people who join Zoom meetings with videos off. They've never come to the headquarters. They've never seen us. The interactions have been only through phone. So the next important thing in terms of how we engage them is literally what I would call convergence and alignment, because they need to kind of start coming in and we need to get them immersed into the organization culture, values, and what it means. And we need to kind of almost get them aligned to the higher purpose of what they are signing up for and what they will deliver, which is also the story of the organization if we need to continue to grow. The third part is if the first and the second, which is the experience and the convergence, alignment and immersion doesn't work, our relationships with the employee will continue to be tactical. There anyway, no emotional connects. The work is what the focus is, and therefore relationship is tactical. So any person who can come and give more money or any one bad experience can make them quit. So for me, it becomes really material in terms of what's the quality of the conversation and what are we signing them up for and how are we immersing them through it to continue to engage and retain. So that's my two bits.
Times from a talent market perspective, it's too early to say whether this is a transient phase or it's a permanent phase. It looks as though it is more transient because you're already seeing certain changes happen again in the talent market. But I think what is really clear is that we are going to be in a new world order in the talent market, and things are never really going to go back to being what they were pre-pandemic. There's obviously a V-shaped catch-up which is happening on attrition. So we saw very few people switch jobs at the beginning of the pandemic, and that suddenly took off in terms of a larger number of people switching jobs, people getting poached across organizations. So it was a frenetic workplace. And I think what became really important in that sort of a talent market is that how do you think, it was a challenge, I think, to all organizations, including us, to say, how do you think about employee engagement at scale in a virtual environment where you have asynchronous conditions of work? You know, I love what you said, Siddiqui Saab, in terms of the nature of work as well as the place of work and the nature of the workforce changing. And how do you think about employee engagement in that sort of a scenario? We also found that employees were becoming more and more unanchored during this time, and therefore changing jobs was becoming easier because think about it, you have large number of employees who've never come to the workplace after joining an organization, especially in a young industry like ours, and therefore engagement did take a beating. Having said that, I think the idea really was for all of us to step back and say, how do you think about providing a consumer grade experience to employees so that they are wanting to stay with you? And we use technology to a large degree to enable that. So a lot of investment in AI-powered collaboration tools that helped us overcome the physical boundaries of remote work, helped us foster connections at the workplace, even while it was not a physical workplace. And whether it was collaboration tools, video calling, Zoom meetings, we would have never thought a couple of years back that we would have a conclave, you know, where everyone is sitting virtually and discussing something important. But these played a very, very vital role in helping us drive employee engagement to the level we wanted. And to sum up, really, I also want to add that technology generally is never enough. It is also what goes along with that, whether it is your culture, it is the empathy that one demonstrated or continues to demonstrate with employees. It is a resilience that employees showed that helped really overcome this really crazy environment around us and helped employees find a sense of purpose, which really is something which is the core of our employee value proposition.
Generation is entering the workforce. They have extremely different expectations than previous generations have had. I'm talking about Gen Z because even millennials have been around for a while in the workforce now. And then we've also just come out of this pandemic, which has really made people rethink what their priorities are, whichever generation they come from, maybe a little bit more the younger generation. And so as we've looked at retaining and engaging talent, we've actually had a really fantastic run through the pandemic and even right now where, we continue to have great retention. We have great, org health scores, which is our engagement survey. And many other indicators that are validating, how employees are feeling. And it's come with a lot of work. So I think one of the first things that we realized as we moved to first virtual, now hybrid working, is that we needed to really invest in manager capability to be able to deal with all of these things. And we started doing that very proactively as we got into the pandemic and have continued to invest in that area, because we've also seen more and more generations of managers become people managers for the first time in an environment where they have not really been able to see role models. They don't really know what it means to handle a difficult situation. How am I supposed to handle it? How do I address some of these situations? So I think this is one thing that definitely has worked for us. And I think again, we have worked a lot on the foundational and the fundamental elements that help retain and engage employees. So culture, capability, careers, they've always been important to employee groups, and they continue to be extremely important in our environment as well. So really, really over-indexed on some of these, because the traditional ways in which we made employees experience the organization are not as available to us anymore as they used to be in the past, where people would come into the office every single day. You'd have so many different people who'd been around longer, who are able to interact with them, etc. Now those are not necessarily as available. People are coming into the office, but not as often and not maybe at the same times as others and for different reasons. I think the other piece that has been really, really important for us is how do you bring purpose to life for this younger generation? And while purpose has been important for a while in the workforce, has really got over-indexed as we are coming to younger millennials and Gen Z. And like you said,
because the key disruptor, I think another disruption which has happened is in the employee expectation from the employer. Right now, things might be looking a little dull with so many layoffs and recession around the corner, but I believe once the dust settles down, employees would no longer expect job security to that extent. I mean, what is it that the employee expects from me? May not be the psychological contract that I'll take care of you, take care of me. I'm here to give you what I do best. You're here to give me what I need to do what I love. So it's apparent that when we are trying to engage the new generation, the buzzword needs to be flexibility. It's not a lifelong contract that we can expect from employees. Flexibility, not just in the new ways of working. It's not just about where I work from. It's where I work from, what kind of work I do, right? Small projects akin to the gig economy, perhaps, multiple projects, bits and pieces, not one job profile for 5 years, right? So flexibility in where I work from, the kind of work I do, the kind of benefits I get. The benefits which appeal to me in the first 5 years of my career are very different from what I will look for in the next 10, which will in turn be different from what I expect in the last 15. So when we try to package the value proposition, we have to segment the employee base to find out what is it that this population expects, considering the stage of life that they are in, the job role that they are doing, the aspirations that they have. So I think in each and every employee offering, flexibility needs to be a buzzword so that we can accommodate their differing needs. And that basically can be a very strong definition of the company culture. Irrespective of what you want, irrespective of where you are in your career, irrespective of where your aspirations lie, we embrace them all and help you realize that. That can be a very strong definition of the company culture. And of course, what Avantika mentioned, the sense of purpose. Now, this generation does not mind taking leave, even if it is without pay, to go for a trek or to go for the rally that he or she might have planned for, right? There are personal aspirations. People do not want to buy cars. They prefer Uber. Don't buy property, rent it out, right? So their needs are very different from the early generations, and helping them find sense of purpose. It's good that they are working, but what is the company doing beyond its core business area?
The impact has happened is that, you know, the hybrid work culture is the mainstream. It is going to remain till the time there is a memory loss about the COVID. Then we also have realized there is a shortage. The critical talent is in shortage. And then with the immigration rules, the way it has happened across the globe, the mobility got impacted. That still remains one of the key challenges for us. Another important aspect is that there has been a realization about the well-being. That is, well-being now is a critical key matrix. At least in the HR hierarchy, the well-being is either number one or number two in terms of the critical HR matrix where the employee sees this as value addition. This is yet to find a place in terms with business leaders. It is there, but not in top two, top three category. The other change is that the way now the human is being seen, talent is being seen as a human capital, that shift is also happening. So we have two capital. The capital we all know, money, and second is the human capital. So whatever we do now, you know, human are to be treated as a capital. Other challenges which remains is that in a hybrid mode or whichever mode we may try to call, we are still not back to normal. There has to be a development and establishment of relationship between the manager and between the leaders and the team managers and the team. If the relationship is not developed, that challenge will remain. And if probably we are able to do all these things, you know, we can probably build a culture which we can call it as learnings from post-COVID.
But I want to harp on two more points, right? More points, or just amplify the points which Prashant said, which is the power of technology. While it is a disruptor, it is definitely an enabler. And organizations, as they try to engage and motivate and retain, I think your collaboration platforms, your ability to reach out to the last mile, I think can only be done through technology. However small, boutique, large organizations you are, your platforms are the power to, you know, have the power to reach that message, whether it is on purpose, whether it is on ESG, CSRs. So if your people are sitting out of wherever and not still listening to you, what you are saying, and you are listening to them, and that can only be done through technology, I think we will not win this race. The other important aspect is on creating trust-based communities within the organization. When I talk about that, I think, yes, the hybrid model is to stay. I can't agree more to getting people back to office. I think I'm a firm believer that we have paid a lot of cost for not coming back to work. Or to office. No, work is the wrong thing, but coming back to office. But I think trust between a manager and an employee and creating opportunities or co-creating platform for your managers to show trust, to have empathy, to create a leadership which talks more from a active listening skill perspective, I think that's going to be a paramount in my view when you are working towards a culture of people first philosophies, right? Because people first philosophy, it's not that many organizations were not doing it, but come COVID and post COVID, I think there is a lot of realization, and it's important to keep technology and trust at a, you know, at the brink of it. So that's my those 2 cents on
stuff. It's time to wrap up. Thank you for joining us. My heartfelt gratitude to our eminent panelists for sharing their knowledge and experience with us. Audience, thank you for listening to us. In case you are looking for any hiring quality talent, Shine.com is your one-stop shop for it. This is your host signing off now.